Sup guys, Arden here with Yellow House Aerial. If you're new here, my name is Arden Shibley and I am a professional drone pilot in Canada. We fly aerials for film and television. Today we're talking about charging Inspire 2 batteries in the car with an inverter. There's a couple things to consider. So you're out on the go and you think you want to charge Inspire 2 batteries in the car. Logically, the best option is an inverter. So you put an inverter in the car, but the problem is that can kill your starting battery. So the solution for that is putting a second battery in the car. We'll get to all these points in a second. Once you have two batteries in the car, that's great, but you don't want the starter battery to die, so you'll want to install an isolator to separate the two batteries and allow the second battery to drain fully without depleting your starting battery, so you can still drive away even after you've been charging batteries. So the isolator is installed and it keeps the second battery separate unless the engine is running, so the voltage is high enough from the alternator to charge the second battery. But you don't want to tax that alternator and get that alternator to charge a second battery from scratch. That's a lot of work for the alternator and you'll blow your alternator a lot sooner than you would have without that second battery. So you'll want to grab an external charger as well. We just got back from a road trip, so I actually have one of the seats missing from my car here, but it allows me to put more gear in and lug some stuff around Alberta and BC for 6 days. We were shooting B-roll on spec, and it went amazingly. Under the hood here, to start it all off, we ran a 4-gauge cable, which is this one, so it's pretty thick as you can see, and there's no question that that's going to be able to handle the amount of wattage and amperage that the second battery would draw, even with an inverter, even with a sub, even with those drone batteries charging. Everything is going to be okay on a thick arse cable like this. So that thick 4-gauge cable goes through the firewall, runs the length of the car, goes through an 80 amp fuse, through the isolator, and then up to this battery. You'll want to make sure that everything you're running and connecting is fused, just in case you have a short. You want to protect your battery and don't weld anything, don't start any fires. Do your research there with your proper wire gauges and proper fuses. The other great thing about a fuse is you can pull the fuse out and it just isolates and disconnects the circuit completely. So it's a great way to just have no question that something is off or disconnected. This is the current setup in the back of my Hyundai Elantra GT, which is a pretty basic run-of-the-mill car, but it has what we need to get the job done. It gets our gear and pilot and camera operator from A to B. There's another video from a gentleman named Jorma Suumann talking about using this LTC 3780 based DC to DC converter chip. So this thing can take any voltage in, and then it can, not any, but within reason, any voltage in and convert it to pretty much any voltage out, which is perfect. We can take 12 volts DC and output it to 26 volts DC, which is what the DJI chargers take. So that's ideal, but this one was dead on arrival, so that's not awesome. For now, what we're doing is converting DC current to AC current with the inverter and back to DC current again, which is not super efficient, but it requires a little bit less gear and a little bit less messing around than the LTC 3780 and allows you to charge your batteries in the car. So this is a Optima YellowTop D34 78 battery, which is a deep cycle battery. It has quite a lot of reserve power and allows you to charge these batteries a lot deeper than a regular car battery would. And you can kill this thing and bring it back to life, no problem, unlike a regular flooded lead car battery. So these YellowTops are great for that. I've got it wired up into an isolator. The isolator is really simple. It's just a positive from your main battery and then a positive out to here, and then it's a little thin ground wire, and I wired that thin ground wire up to, I don't know if you can see it, a little switch right here, and if I flip that switch it connects the isolator and connects the front battery to the back battery if the voltage on the front battery is over 13.4 volts, which is really only when the alternator is running. And if I do this, then it completely isolates this circuit. So this battery and my inverter and the subwoofer, because I like it bassy, are all on their own circuit running off of this battery with no input from the front battery at all. So I mentioned that charging this battery from scratch on your alternator is a bad idea and you will kill it sooner than later. So you'll want to get actually an external charger for the battery. So here I have a Noco Genius 3500, which is basically just a really intelligent AC 110 volt to DC 12 volt converter. And it has a mode for an absorbed glass mat battery like this one, and it charges it in a very specific way and keeps it at a nice float voltage to keep the battery healthy and lasting long, and it will charge it from scratch all the way up to full without using your alternator at all, which is what you want. I'll put the link for this below, as well as the battery and that video from Jorma Suumann. He uses the LTC3780 to convert the DC voltage straight, which is a little bit more efficient, but takes a little bit more mucking around. And Jorma's setup has no battery protection there at all, so there's no way to charge batteries without running your alternator at full tilt or risking killing your charging battery. This setup allows you to charge batteries anywhere, anytime, without any direct impact on the vehicle. So this is a run-of-the-mill 500-watt inverter that takes DC to your regular AC plug. It's an Eliminator, but 500 watts is what you need to run two DJI chargers, because these are about 200 watts apiece when they're working. And then obviously you're running a lot of juice, so you'll want to be considerate of what type of wire you're using. Definitely use something thick. This is 8-gauge, this is 6-gauge here. You probably wouldn't want to go any smaller than 8 for running 400 watts, which is about 40 amps. That's quite a bit of power to be drawing. So now that this is all hooked up, I'm going to go ahead, make sure this is isolated here. Technically, they're already isolated. This switch is only for during or after heavy inverter use, where you've drained the yellow top deeply and you don't want to stick the alternator with charging it from dead. That way you can take the drained yellow top back to somewhere where you have a wall outlet and recharge it with the NOCO. I can turn on the inverter. The fan comes on in the inverter. It's letting me know that I'm mostly maxed out and I only have about 100 watts of inversion power left. And the batteries are both charging. So this will just run and run until this battery is dead. And I can drive like this, no problem. I can use the alternator to supplement the power that we have here, or I can just isolate it and just kill this battery and charge it with the NOCO once I get to my destination or once I'm done shooting. I'm kind of all about easy connect and disconnect. Being able to disconnect my subwoofer and take it out, or disconnect this battery and take it out, is really great. It's just, I don't want to use tools. I want to be able to do it quickly. So this whole thing was a bit of a learning experience. So I have a couple of different plugs. I'm just going to show you them quickly. Connecting the battery, I used the thick 4-gauge cables here, and I used locking 3-prong AC plugs. It would typically be for your regular wall outlet. I used one for positive from the isolator and one for ground going to a bolt in the car, and it comes back and goes to the ground of the battery. So these things are a little expensive from your local Rona or Lowe's or whatever, but they work nicely, they lock, there's no question, and they definitely have enough room for the amperage for what you're doing. This connector is an XT60. It's normally used for model airplanes sort of thing. It is a non-sparking connector. It can handle a decent amount of amperage, and this is sort of reserved for future use with a 50 amp fuse. What I'm going to do is get another DC to DC solution like the LTC3780, and I'm going to use direct plugs, barrel plugs, with DC voltage into these so I don't have to convert DC to AC to DC current again. So on my sub and previously on my inverter, I was using what are called Molex plugs, which are nice. They only plug in one way, and they're pretty cheap, which is good. But the problem is when I plugged in the inverter to a different type, it was a 4-prong Molex, there wasn't enough amperage available through that plug because these things are tiny little pins in there and they just can't handle 500 watts. So it was getting hot when I was running both the chargers off there and the inverter was beeping at me. So I've since gone and replaced it. That's why I'm using this 6-gauge cable going into what is instead called an Anderson plug, which can handle a lot of wattage. This thing can handle 50 amps and it's huge. It's really secure and this is no problem. It's not going to get hot. So this runs right over to the inverter, and of course the whole thing is hooked into this cable, which goes over underneath straight to the isolator on the battery. So it's also nice if you're working at night to be able to see what you're doing. So this is the light that's built into the trunk, but I went ahead and grabbed some 12 volt strip LEDs and wired them in there. So those lights go off when the trunk shuts. And then on this side, I wired another set straight to the yellow top battery. So a switch back here, I can flick that and on they come, if it will ever focus. So I can turn them on and off. They will stay on or they will go off and stay off. Doesn't matter if the trunk is open or not. And because they're connected to the yellow top, they won't kill the car battery. So anyway, that is the current DC to AC to DC setup for charging Inspire 2 batteries in the Hyundai Elantra. You could set up anything like this in your car. The setup cost is probably $500 to $600. The battery is about $300. That'll be your biggest cost. Anyway, if you have any questions or you have a charging setup of your own that you'd like to share or just talk about, you can comment below. If you like this video, give us a like. Be sure to subscribe to check out what else we're into. Blah, blah, blah. Thank you for watching. My name is Arden Shibley for Yellow House Aerial, and I will see you in the next video. Yeah.